So Dr. Scholz, we have a couple questions from our YouTube channel regarding pre-treatment. And the first question is, when should a man start to get DREs? And is it annual? Is it every 2 years? What does that look like?
This is the unpleasant finger in the behind test that some people debate whether it needs to be done at all, given that we have PSA testing. PSA testing is certainly much more sensitive, meaning detects more cancer than digital rectal exams do. And some have been concerned that by advocating digital rectal exams that men are put off and don't even come in for their PSA tests. But there are types of prostate cancer that can be detected by digital rectal exam when the PSA is still in the normal range. And it turns out that those types of prostate cancers are the type you want to diagnose. They're the more dangerous types, the ones that don't make as much PSA. They're not very common, but it's a simple test. And it takes very brief time, and it should be performed in people that want to be thorough and make sure that they don't have a they don't end up dying of a preventable illness. So the age that is advocated varies from different groups. Probably the most aggressive stance is to start around age 40. The thinking is maybe in African Americans or people with a family history to start around age 40. Other more conservative organizations think around age 50. Why hesitate? Why not check it in 30-year-olds? It's a cheap test. But there's always a trade-off. The industry, the surgical industry, is very aggressive in treating people with prostate cancer, and no one disputes that many men are overtreated. So there's always this kind of love-hate relationship with PSA because it can lead to people getting unnecessary surgery, which can ruin your quality of life, sexual life, urinary function, etc. So that's why there's always a balance. And there have been organizations in the past that said don't even do PSA testing, but we won't go into that now. Whenever PSA testing starts, that's when digital rectal exam should start. And if there's an age which you stop PSA testing, and that's another debate, then maybe that's when the digital rectal exam should end. So annual PSA testing with digital rectal exams, I think, would be reasonable to start around age 40 to 45.
So we get a lot of questions regarding people getting secondary biopsy reviews. What is that process like? Do they have to get another biopsy?
Yeah, so that is a misconception. When people undergo a biopsy, the little cores that are removed from the prostate are transferred, they're sliced very thinly, and then they're transferred onto glass slides. And the people that process this, the pathologists, look at those slides under the microscope and assign a Gleason score. The good news is those glass slides are almost immortal. I believe that most of the centers that process these slides are required by law to keep the slides in an archive for at least 5 to 10 years. So they will always be there for evaluation if they need to be evaluated again in the future. So it's not at all difficult then to have those glass slides put in the mail and sent off to an expert somewhere. We've used Johns Hopkins a lot for this purpose. And for a small fee, have a world-class prostate pathologist review the images or through the microscope and render their own opinion as to what the grade is. And assigning a Gleason score is a bit subjective, and we rely so heavily on this information. And so the difference between a 3+4 and a 4+3 or a 3+3 and a 3+4 is huge. People routinely advocate that 3+3 should simply be watched, and many doctors say that 3+4 should be treated. So it's a fulcrum point that can be incredibly important, and I certainly do see changes in Gleason score all the time in people that initially were evaluated in some community center, and then when a reference center, an academic center of excellence, re-reviews the slides and the Gleason score changes. So it's a good starting place to make sure that you can trust the Gleason score by having a center of excellence review the pathology slides. It's not difficult to do.
Speaking of Gleason score, we have a person who's kind of wondering, what is the intensity of cancer considering they have Gleason 7, but they have perineural invasion?
So perineural invasion, it comes up a lot because you see it in the pathology reports. And I believe that Dr. Epstein did a nice video on Gleason scoring for us at the PCRI at one time, so people can access that information. But it turns out that although the pathologists talk about perineural invasion, which merely means that the cancer cells can be seen in the biopsy specimen to be growing along the edge of a nerve. The original concern is that the nerves lead outside the prostate, and therefore the cells can track along the surface of the nerve and get outside the prostate. And if a person is going to have a radical prostatectomy and their nerves outside the prostate, then the doctor's going to leave some cancer behind, and it won't all be removed at the time of surgery. Very relevant. It's been shown that if you look at other important factors like the Gleason score, the number of core biopsies positive, how high the PSA is, whether or not someone has perineural invasion doesn't really have any impact on the long-term outcome. So you just go back to the what is the Gleason score, and pretty much jettison the whole question of whether or not there's perineural invasion. Does it impact surgery to some degree? I suppose there is a scenario where you could cook up an idea where it might make a difference. I'm, as most people know, not an advocate of surgery for prostate cancer, given the options, the alternatives are so much better than surgery. But maybe it would be a question that would arise in someone that just insists on having a radical prostatectomy and has appropriate care been exercised to make sure that there's no extracapsular extension.
Have you found that lesions that are missed on an MRI can be seen on color Doppler imaging?
Occasionally. The good news is that relatively little is missed on multiparametric MRI, and that technology is rendered even more powerful when doctors are looking at sequential images from year to year. So they can take last year's images, put them up right next to this year's images, and see if there are any slight differences. Color Doppler is an independent imaging method. It looks at sound waves bounced off of the image rather than electromagnetic radio waves emitted in a high-intensity magnetic field. And so, yes, sometimes we will see things on color Doppler that are not seen on MRI. Some of the things that we would see on color Doppler will be low-grade lesions. MRI is semi-famous for missing Gleason 6, which is a good thing. We don't really want to know about Gleason 6, but color Doppler probably picks up Gleason 6 a little bit better than MRI does. And so you have to be restrained in getting overexcited about little spots, because sometimes they're just low-grade lesions that can be watched.
Thanks for watching. If you would like more information about prostate cancer, you can go ahead and subscribe to our YouTube channel. We come out with new prostate cancer videos every week. And go ahead and visit our website, pcri.org. We have tons of information on prostate cancer that will help you.